Good afternoon, and welcome to the first of three sessions for Olin's inaugural Family Investment and Impact Series, sponsored by the Koch Center for Family Business. I'm Mark Taylor, and I'm privileged to say that I'm the Dean of the Olin Business School. And I'm especially excited for today's session, moderated by Koch Professor for Family Enterprise, Peter Boumgarden. Peter will be joined on stage by Scott Wilson, CIO of Washington University Investment Management Company, fresh off his team's industry-leading performance in the university endowment space. Alongside Scott will be long-term investor and finance guru, Brent Beshore, CEO and founder of Permanent Equity. Their discussion will cover direct and fund investment strategies and the capabilities required by families and family offices to do this work effectively. And many thanks to each of you for joining us today and for all that you do for Olin. We hope that this event is just one of the many ways that we can give back as an institution through the opportunities to learn and grow together. Finally, I would, of course, be remiss if I did not also thank the entire Koch family, Paul, Roger, Fran, and Alki, for their generosity in endowing the Koch Center for Family Business and all the community programming, academic research, and student engagement this philanthropy enables. So, without further ado, please welcome my colleague, Peter Boumgarden.
Thank you, Mark. I appreciate the time and the kind words of introduction. I was joking with the guys earlier that I made sure I had really kind of strong introductions that made you blush a little bit beforehand, but really excited to have our time here. I want to just make a quick comment on the Koch Center in particular. First off, echoing the thanks that I would have of the entire Koch family for their work, but to give you a sense of what we've been doing in the last little bit of time. So one piece in particular has been this shift from family business alone to all things family enterprise. And in particular, part of what we mean by that is this shift to cover all things family business, the actual core part of the business, the way in which business, sometimes the ability to do elements of all things investment, and then finally to think more broadly about impact and philanthropic work. And so much of the work that we'll be bringing towards you in our work moving forward will be covering all of those different bases, not forgetting the core aspect of business, but be able to engage in events like this that see the family enterprise from a slightly different angle. I'm excited to do that in the formats of our event as well, in the format of the center in particular. In particular, one of the things that we do is we try to engage with you all as community, to engage with our students more broadly, and to do so as informed by the academic work. So work has been done on venture capital, work has been done on private equity, work has been done on family office investment. And to be able to bring that live to you all is a piece of what it means to be a university center in particular. I do want to highlight that this is the first out of three events that we'll be running with the center on this particular series. The first one, obviously, here today, dealing with strategies of direct investment, but we'll transition shortly afterwards in February to all things impact investment, which we might cover slightly here today. And then finally, once we get to April, to deal with issues of being more strategic in philanthropic work as well. So a number of events that we'll be bringing forward over the course of the next couple months, and we'll make sure that you're aware of them as we do so. One of the things that I want to do just to get us started is to again, give us a set of the context around why we have these two individuals here. Their bios and their background are impressive, as I mentioned earlier, but I think especially relevant to the questions that we'll be dealing with today. So I'm not going to make you blush too much more, Scott. I'm going to be brief on this, but I do want to give some of your bio. Scott came to us in 2017 from Grinnell College, but has a very distinguished career in the investment world beforehand, the head of rates options trading for Barclays Capital Japan, including various trading and quant roles at the Bank of America Securities in Tokyo, Chicago, and London. We don't hold it against him too much, but he's also the graduate of two of our rival institutions, Grinnell College as well as University of Chicago. So great to have you here as well. Brent is the CEO and founder of Permanent Equity, a Missouri-based private equity group that invests in small to mid-sized North American firms with no intention of selling. He's going to talk a bit about that model in a bit. He leads the firm and more specifically the acquisition and diligence teams while supporting the portfolio operations. He's the author of a book called The Messy Marketplace about selling your business, and a graduate of one of our other rivals, William and Lee University, with a degree in political science and, interestingly enough, an emphasis in poverty studies as well. All right, So with that said, let's hop into it. And we're going to talk about approaches to investing here shortly. But in fact, I want to start with a bit of your bio. I gave you the bio lines, but I want to actually hear a little bit about the particular parts of your background that you think shape your approach to investing. So if you were to say, I invest this way because of the fact that I am from Alaska, or I played college basketball, or I fill in the blank, those are just two random potential options. We'd love to hear a bit of that. So Scott, why don't we start with you?
Sure. I'm not sure you can point to like one specific thing. Probably the most impactful thing was the mentors I've had over the course of my career. I started way back kind of in the original tech bubble called the 90s. And I started in investment banking, equity research. Like there was a guy there by the name of Mike Mobison who was kind of a guru even back then, and kind of directed equity research products. So I remember just scavenging the earth and reading everything that he had written and then trying to find somebody who could actually explain it to me at the time. But I would say, like, you know, and my boss at the time, this guy named Greg Capelli, who was a great mentor, still a good friend, was also influential. You know, I took that and then ended up going into this kind of quant trading world, which again, I think really helped shape how I think about correlation and volatility and portfolio construction, but certainly didn't come through a traditional path to be in kind of a asset allocator role.
Yeah, great. In fact, that's one of the things that, Brent, you and I have talked about in terms of this path, distinct, not coming through a traditional finance-oriented path in the direction of this world, so probably some degrees of overlap between those worlds as well. So, Brent, for you, same question. When it comes to the pieces of your world, your story that shape your approach to investing in particular, what comes to mind for you?
Yeah, well, I mean, I joke that I'm the Forrest Gump of private equity because, like, can barely open up Excel and never worked at another firm. And, I mean, I accidentally bought a business. That's how I got into this world. So, you know, whatever the non-traditional path is, I mean, I certainly fell backwards into it. And I think that, you know, the firm that we built has been, you know, just try to be intellectually honest about what we're looking at in front of us. I mean, it's one of my favorite things about talking with Scott is it's always just very first principles and, you know, where are you seeing value, where are you seeing opportunities? And it always sort of trends away from kind of where all the crowd is going, or at least, you know, you try to get kind of out of where the crowd has been. And for us, I mean, when we saw an opportunity to buy, I bought my first business actually here in St. Louis in 2009. And, you know, I joke, I'm 38, I look probably about 25 now, I looked about 14 then, and sat across the table from this guy and said, you know, I think I want to try to buy your business. Got introduced through mutual acquaintance, and, you know, he looked at me and said, two grown men have tried to buy my business, like, how are you going to buy it? And I don't know, I'll figure it out. I got an SBA loan and bought it, and it was a huge risk. I just got married, my wife asked me, she said, you know, what is this personal guarantee thing that you're asking me to sign, and, like, is it bad? Like, and I'm like, well, it'll be challenging. Yeah, we'll talk about it a little later. You know, just sign it. And so, you know, that was really my entry point, was just buying a business on my own. You know, thank goodness for the SBA, and really opening my eyes to this whole area of the world that you know, transition businesses, family owned businesses that had no succession. And so, you know, that's really where I felt like you know, really could make a career. And it was uncrowded at the time. It's gotten more crowded since. We can talk about that, sort of how capital's going into that area, but. I mean, what influenced me was just being an operator. Like, I love business. I love the nuts and bolts of it, execution of it. I mean, we certainly are investors and grateful for WashU being our largest investor. But, I mean, we don't really think our mentality is not really an investment mentality. I mean, the numbers really make sense in the deals that we're doing. We're buying them for a low enough multiple where, you know, as long as things don't go terribly, like, we're going to be fine. What we really think about is just the improvement and the opportunity to have these businesses flourish over a long period of time, and the way that we're capital structured allows us to do that.
So let me just point to one piece that you just mentioned and see if we can double-click on it. When you say we don't have a primary investment mentality, more of an operator's mentality, what do you think that looks like in practice? How do you behave differently than some of your peers that might be more investment oriented in their approach?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's definitely an intellectual pursuit to what we do, but a lot of the businesses we're buying, I mean, these are blue-collar owners. I mean, they got into the business because, you know, they loved construction or they loved manufacturing, right? And they worked their way up from the assembly line. You know, these are not, you know, philosopher kings. Yep. These are people who, you know, this is the first time I've been out of blue jeans in, I don't know, 2 months. You know, even if we're in, you know, big city, I mean, we're typically dressing down because we're buying businesses that are for the most part, run by practitioners. And so the way we relate to them is we can relate to them not as saying, hey, we know about this great bond strategy, or we can, you know, talk to you about alpha versus beta and, you know, these type of terminology. They have no idea what we're talking about. Yep. We talk to them in terms of like, hey, how are you incentivizing your sales team, right? Yep. Like, how are we thinking about, you know, optimizing the plant for production, those types of things. And so when we think about the day-to-day, what we really try to be excellent at, it's the investing, the sort of the numbers and the score takes care of itself. It's all about the people and all about the operations of the business, and that's how the returns get produced.
Right. So one of my favorite interviewers out there is Tyler Cowen, an economist out of George Mason. And one of the favorite questions that he tees up for people is to ask about their unique production function. So what it is that they do that allows them to do what they do at the highest level. Might be how they read, how they think, who they surround themselves with. So I'm curious, as we hop into your stories for each of you, how would you explain your own unique production function? Scott, why don't you kick us off on this one?
I guess I would start off saying, like, I'm not sure how unique it is. I can tell you what, like, how I think we're starting with this pool of capital, which is our primary input. We have a team that manages that capital. We probably have a small bit of intellectual property. We have a brand. You know, we're a good cause. People generally like that. And ultimately, we're trying to generate, you know, great long-term returns with all those inputs. Now, how do we do that? I would say, like, we go out and find external partners like Brent, who we think are well-aligned with us and institution and view the world in a similar way and can add value to our portfolio over super long periods of time. I would say, you know, as it approaches to direct investments is like, how do you maximize that production function and how do you maximize our relationship with external partners like permanent equity? And typically that's through some form of direct investments where we work super closely with those partners. We understand what they're doing. We understand what in their portfolio, the process that led to those investments. And when we find stuff that our partners are super excited about, you know, we'll start doing our own work on that. And then ultimately, if we can, we'll try and insert ourselves into the cap table, typically in partnership with that external partner.
So let me push on this, because I love that framing. And a lot of it's around the unique production function of the institution, the fund that you run. What about you as Scott? What is it that you do uniquely that fuels that production function?
You know, I try and spend the vast majority of my time is just operating as another member of the investment staff. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, I have other responsibilities to the university and the board, but I typically that's less than 5-10% of my time. I'm doing the same sort of analysis and work that the rest of the team is. We're on calls. If we go out to Columbia to meet with Brent and his team, I'm just another person there, and I may not even be leading the meeting. It may be the whoever the head on that investment is, who's put together their kind of, hey, here are the big high points we want to hit. And I think that's super important, just the way we take a team approach, and we're all generalists. For me to be involved early in the process, I think, you know, it's disheartening if you have kind of this gatekeeper who sits at the top of the portfolio and the team is out there doing all this work, comes back and says, hey, we think this is a great investment. And I'm like, well, we're not investing in a private equity firm in Columbia, Missouri. That's just a non-starter. I don't know who brought that. Who thought that was going to be?
We'll find them later.
Yeah.
Find them later.
Anyway, so, you know, that's really how I spend my time.
Good. I like that. So, Brent, same question. When it comes to either the firm's unique production function and, I should say, your unique production function, how would you describe that?
Yeah, I mean, in private equity, I mean, for the most part, we're selling money. I mean, that's at least how the industry looks at it. And I actually think that a lot of what makes Scott, I mean, let me say a few things about WashU, because I mean, we talked to 30 of the top 50 endowments in the country during our last fundraise, right? And WashU clearly stood out of the crowd in a number of ways, but what was attractive to us about it was they shared a similar vision for sort of how you go about doing business. And what I would say is like, a high degree of intellectual honesty and humility was like an incredibly refreshing thing. In a lot of endowments, the conversations we had where we know what's awesome. We know we're amazing. We're an incredible team. We're so smart. Do you know, see all our degrees? Do you see, you know, it's like this very...
That doesn't sound like universities at all.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I had no idea. You know, the WashU team was like, you know, I think we talked about fishing for, it's funny as that sounds, like we're like real people. And it was like real relationships that we had. And the questions they asked in such a way that it wasn't presupposing the answer. And I think that's what a lot of it makes us successful. What we do is we go in with humility and with respect and treating people as people, you know, not as a means to an end, but as the end in themselves. Mm-hmm. And people can just tell, right? I mean, you can say all the right words, but if you say it with you know, sort of disdain and condescension, people can tell, you know? And I think that's what, you know, I admire so much about what they do, and we, you know, we try to do a lot of that at our shop, is just, you know, how do you relate to people? And at the end of the day, I mean, we're all trying to do the same thing. We want to raise healthy families. We want to have enjoyable lives. Like, we're all trying to, you know, achieve the same end. We're trying to shoot the lights out in terms of returns. I mean, our, you know, make no mistake about it. I mean, we're people-centric, but we believe that is by far the best way to produce long-term returns. And I can tell you, the reason why they shot the lights out is because they have the best relationships. They have the best relationships because, you know, I'll tell you a little side story. I called Scott in the depth of COVID, and I said, Scott, like, you know, we're fine, I think. I mean, we've got, you know, a couple years of runway, but, like, I'm starting to worry if, you know, I can create a scenario where all this happens. And he said, literally, stop. We've got your back. Whatever you guys need, we're there with you for the long term. Like, you have no idea how much that meant to me and, like, how it enabled our team and gave us the confidence to just charge forward. And it was a huge boost for us, right? We try to do that same thing for our businesses, which aligns with us and aligns with our investors, right? How we're going to produce great long-term returns is through relationships. How you produce great relationships is actually caring about people.
Yep. Good. So we're going to shift to your particular models here in a bit. And you'll notice that we're talking about family, investment, and philanthropy, but neither of these two individuals is at the core of family office. And I wanted to pull the two of you together because I think there are lessons about how you've structured your work that is relevant for families doing the actual work of direct investment. So let's start with you, Brent, on this. I want to hear a bit about your model, about the permanent equity model, and what makes it different from some of your competitors in this space. And then a follow-on question that we'll dig into is, why is that potentially relevant for families doing this work? Scott, we're going to come back to you on endowments shortly afterwards.
Yeah, I mean, so I would say the traditional private equity model is, we call it the buy, lever, strip, and flip model, right? So you buy a business, you lever it to the moon, you put as much debt on as you possibly can. You know, you try to improve the financial metrics, which oftentimes is far easier to cut than it is to grow. I mean, we can talk about it a little later. I think private equity firms would say that they grow businesses. There's a lot that do, and there's some great people operating in the private equity space, right, that don't operate this way. But I would say the norm is the, like, sort of leverage buyout model. You're trying to put a bunch of debt on the business. You're trying to get cash flow up as much as you can. All that discretionary cash flow is typically going to pay down debt in the interim. And then you're going to try to sell it to somebody else, right? Hopefully you've had some growth in the interim. The bottom line's going to look a heck of a lot better. And if you think about it, if you're not going to, you know, own the business for more than 3, maybe 4 or 5 years at most, you know, you're not going to make long-term investments in people. You're not going to make long-term investments in strategy. It's a very short-term mentality. And look, it's worked, right? I mean, you know, you can buy things and lever them to the moon, and if you can sell them for a little bit more in the market, you know, the right way, things work out. You know, for us, that's not the way we think about the world, and I think what aligns with our vision of what reality should be is how families think about it. We've literally never bought a business where that we come in and we look at their balance sheet and they've just got a bunch of debt because they, you know, did a dividend recap out of the business. Like, literally never seen a family do that. Why would, if a family doesn't do dividend recaps, would a private equity firm? Well, it's just pure financial return. It's a short-term strategy. For us, and COVID was a great example of this, you know, we typically are carrying zero debt, at least zero operational debt across any of our businesses. That gives us incredible discretion over the cash flow that comes off these companies to hire people when everyone else is firing. What does that look like? That looks like COVID. I mean, literally, our businesses, we were aggressive hiring. We got talent we couldn't get in 2 decades. We were able to get in 5 months because everyone else was tightening their, you know, their belt, and all the banks, they were having to renegotiate covenants, spending all their time focused on the financial engineering. We were focused on the operations. We were putting in new ERP systems. You know, I mean, our aerospace business is a good example of that. I mean, while we had volume drop by 70% at one point, well, we've got a warehouse staff that's not very busy. Well, what are we going to do? We've got a, you know, sales team that's not very busy. Why don't we work on improving the business so that we slingshot out of this thing and we end up grabbing market share out the other side? That's a long-term business strategy. Whereas if you're loaded up with debt, I mean, you're spending all your time renegotiating with banks and taking all that cash flow and putting it someplace else. You can't hire. You can't make big investments. So I think that that's where, you know, it's a simple model, but almost no one does it. Well, why does almost no one do it? Because no one has the tap capital that we do. I mean, WashU is one of the ones that believed in us and said, we understand that long-term compounding actually matters. We want to run these companies like, you know, like families have, for durability over the long term, which we think is a higher rate of return, period, because we have discretion to invest in things like that. Well, we did that by getting basically capital for three decades, right? There's interim distributions, but the capital, the initial capital is locked up for three decades. It takes a lot of trust, and I think that's, again, where it goes back to relationships. Like, we can't do what we do without relationships. We can't do what they do without relationships.
So to some degree, you're having to find capital that is interested in those types of ends. And also, I would imagine, an education component of telling people that are coming to you and saying, our model is a bit different. Is it a mix of those two? You have to find the Scotts of the world that are out there that already start to believe that approach, as well as educate some of your investors on how to engage?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that the pitch to families is really easy, these families that are selling the business. I mean, it's they don't even understand that, like, you're going to put a bunch of debt on the business. Like, why would you do that? It's kind of like a weird, necessary evil. I mean, that's not the way they've been operating. So when we come in, it's actually interesting. We struggle with the first discussions, because if you don't know what the alternative is, it doesn't make us look that special. They're like, well, that's great that you're not putting debt on the business. Like, who cares? It's like, well, no, everyone else is doing this. Everyone else is going to resell you within 3 to 5 years. And they're like, wait, what? That wasn't part of the deal, right? And so I think that's where, you know, to the families on that side, it's very clear. You know, there are very few people, though. I mean, you know, long-term thinking in the financial world is measured in months, not even usually years. So when we start talking about decades and locking up capital for decades, people get very nervous very quickly. And I mean, look, I mean, Scott can talk to it. I mean, I'm sure it was a hurdle that they had to really talk through. There's a different risk factors to us than there are other investments. And I mean, we take that very seriously. So yeah, I mean, we had a lot of people laugh at us. I mean, we had one family foundation that we were talking to, and the guy said, heck no, we're not going to invest in you. I mean, look, 25 years from now, you're going to be on your third wife. You're going to be spending time with your stepkids and your vacation homes. Like, you know, heck no, we're not going to invest in you. I was like, well, that seems like an oddly specific set of, you know, assumptions. But, you know, fair enough. The answer is no.
Great. So Scott, for you, when it comes to how your model differs from other endowments, in particular university endowments, what does that look like, and what are the potential implications for families that are doing investment?
So I would say, like, first, if you just looked at our portfolio top down, we would look like most of the other large endowments. Now you'd see some, like, minor discrepancies between, like, okay, we probably have slightly less in hedge funds than some of our peers. We may have slightly less in traditional private, well, quite a bit less probably in traditional private equity, more in different types of asset classes. But generally, they're going to be pretty similar portfolios in terms of public equities, private equity, real assets, cash, fairly simple portfolio. When you take a step down, I think is where you would see, like, one, we're probably quite a bit more concentrated at the partnership level. So we have fewer partners, and we tend to be looking for smaller firms that we can partner more closely with and understand what they're doing and why they're doing it and you know, how they do it, and one, how that builds up into our overall portfolio construction. And then when you take a step lower than that, I would say we would be, you know, quite a bit more concentrated at the individual position level, and that all kind of builds on top of itself. For sure, if you look at our kind of concentration in our top 20 positions, and we break this out for the board in terms of top 10, top 20, every meeting, that concentration has more than quadrupled over the last 4 years. As we've turned over the portfolio, got new partners, built conviction in some of their individual names, and then done direct investments on top of that.
So I'd love for you to dig into that piece in particular, because when I've heard you talk about this concentration piece, the front end, it feels somewhat counterintuitive. But I'd love for you to explain where concentration factors into that investment thesis. Why is it better to have greater concentration in a smaller number of partners?
Well, I would say, like, a simple example for kind of over-diversification. If you think about your portfolio, if you're invested in a partnership and they own 20 stocks, you know, and you have $100 million and it's equally spread out, right, you have $5 million worth of exposure in each of those 20 stocks or 20 individual assets. You know, if you own 20 of those names, or 20 partnerships like that, all of a sudden you have 400 stocks in your portfolio. So now you're essentially an index fund. Like, quantitatively speaking, you're an index fund once you get that diversified. But you still have this kind of active management layer of fees. And if you are paying a carry on those funds, like, it's even more problematic because you're short that basket of call options on performance, and being short a basket and options is way worse than being short an option on a basket.
So not only... We're going to use that quote at some point in the future. That's a nice little quote.
Yeah. So you're like, it's really tough, like, probabilistically speaking, for that portfolio to perform well over large periods of time. So we think about our portfolio as kind of this aggregation of these underlying exposures, and then we have a fee and liquidity structure layered on top of that. Now, I think a lot of times when you get, you know, siloed approaches to portfolio management, and a lot of people do it that way, and I'm sure it can be done, but the guy running the public equity portfolio and the guy running the private equity portfolio, he's basically kind of trying to maximize his performance. He doesn't necessarily care what this guy over in hedge fund space is doing or the guy over in real estate investing is doing, right? He's got this kind of silo of assets, and he wants a diversified portfolio, right? So he's limited to how much career risk, even though he may have an investment over here that's in, you know, biotech related, and we may have very similar investments in the private portfolio. But again, like, what he cares about is his slice of the portfolio. Whereas, you know, we're looking to diversify the portfolio at the kind of top-down level, but within each asset class, we could care less how much diversification we have, knowing that we want to be broadly diversified across asset class and geography at the highest level. Yeah.
So I want to transition now a little bit more directly into families doing some of this work, family offices, family foundations, et cetera. And I want to start with maybe an unusual starting point, a short article by the philosopher Agnes Callard, who I find just to be an exceptionally insightful thinker, University of Chicago grad, mm-hmm. or I should say University of Chicago professor. So maybe one of your old professors mm-hmm. if you took more classes in philosophy. No. So her piece in particular talks about this idea about being against advice. And the core element of this is she says most advice is bad because it mixes some degree of what it is that you should value and how it is you should do that. So think of your traditional graduation speech. You should be successful like me, and here's how you go about doing that. So for the rest of the time today, or for most of the time today, I'm going to do my best to start to split apart this who question, who should be doing it, from the how question, how should they do it. And in particular, I want to start with the who on the family side, and maybe to frame it even more directly, to think about when it comes to the landscape of family offices or families doing investment work. How do you think about the ones that should be doing a healthy portion of their portfolio in direct investment? So, in other words, do they have to have certain objectives that are driving this? Do they have to have certain resources that are there in place? What are the conditions where we might say, this is a who that should be doing this type of work that we'll talk about for the rest of our time together?
I'm happy to start, I guess. First off, I'd say, look, this is super difficult, like direct investing. Second, I'd say like 90% of your time is gonna be unproductive. So we have a large kind of investment office. We have a lot of resources, and we spend thousands and thousands of hours doing kind of diligence and research on stuff that never makes it into the portfolio. And our hit ratio on direct investments, I'm not even gonna say it's one out of 100, it's more like 1 out of 1,000 that we look at that we ultimately makes it into the portfolio. So that one, it's really hard, it's really difficult. You have to have the team and the resources to do it. And then you also have to be super humble about it. I mean, there's lots of stuff that comes in the door and we say like, hey, we don't have the internal skill set to underwrite this. Even if we like, you know, could get people within the medical school or, you know, resources within the university to help us underwrite the initial business, like we can't keep tabs, we can't understand the marketplace, we just don't know enough about this type of business to have this in our portfolio where we would say thumbs up or thumbs down. Now, like we'd be super happy for somebody like Brent to maybe make that same investment, but we're not gonna double down on it because we wouldn't invest alongside them
Let me just pause there just to clarify. So you're looking at 1,000. Out of that 1,000, you might have one that you say yes to. Sometimes you say no because it's not a good investment. Sometimes you say no because we don't actually have the expertise to know this business, especially clearly.
And then you have to manage that investment over the next 10 plus years, yep. right? And yep. that's where that expertise comes in, I think, particularly.
So that gives us a sense of filter. Is it a fair way to reframe it then that in order to do this kind of work, you would have to have a significant amount of expertise, time, individuals to be able to do the work that we're talking about today?
Yeah, I think there's a good reason why a lot of people don't do direct investing is because there is a negative selection bias, right? If you're just sitting there waiting to like pick up the phone and for whatever reason you're invested in, you know, a big private equity firm, and they call you up, hey, we have a co-investment in this, like, chances are they've called a bunch of strategic partners, other people who could, like, actually add value to the deal outside of just capital.
By the time they're calling me, they're at the...
You got to be humble and say, like, we're probably not the first call.
Yeah, I'm just laughing. There's a buddy of mine in Texas who said, if you ever see an oil deal come out of Texas, just know I passed on it twice.
Yes,
we think about that a lot, right?
Yes, yeah.
And I would echo, we always think about it, who does the work? That's a question we ask around our office a lot, is who does the work? And I would just say to family offices, I mean, we've seen a lot of family offices lose a lot of money very quickly in our area of the market, right? So call it, you know, sub $20 million EBITDA businesses. It is a highly inefficient market. And when you think about market efficiency, this is, I mean, I remember the first time I heard about this, maybe it's been from Mobison, actually. You know, he said the definition of efficiency or inefficiency is, can you intentionally lose money or not, right? And you look at the public markets, can you intentionally lose money by investing in the public markets? It's more difficult, right? I mean, my argument would be, you buy, you know, you say, I'm just trying to, like, you know, go short some stock, and it might go up a lot, you know, or it might go down a lot, you know, you might win, right? In our area of the market, you can very easily lose your money very quickly, and you can do it very intentionally if you wanted to, right? So it means skill really matters, and it matters a lot, and you're going to have to pay expensive tuition. Somebody paid expensive tuition to learn. What I would say is so the story that we didn't really talk about is not like we busted on the scene and raised a bunch of money and we're going to try to do this. Like, our history was, we basically did it for a decade with our own capital that we compounded, right, from that SBA loan, paid it back, started compounding capital, and took it very, very, very slowly over a long period of time to build our systems, to build judgment and expertise. You know, we're in the same boat of, because I mean, we're doing direct investments, obviously, as the GP. We're looking at, you know, a couple thousand deals a year to get to 2 to 5 a year, hopefully, that we get really, really serious and close. So, I mean, the numbers are very similar in terms of, you know, 1 out of 1,000, you know, maybe 2 or 3 out of 1,000 if we're really, you know, striking it well. And I would just say is, you know, we had a family office the other day that came to us, and we were talking to one of their investment directors, and they had lost $100 million out of $140 million that they had invested over about a 5-year period. And I said, how in the world do you lose that much money? He said, well, you make 10 bad investments. You know, and it's like, as funny as that sounds, I mean, somebody's got to do the work. So somebody's got to not only evaluate the business, but these businesses don't run themselves post-close. Like, somebody's got to do the work. And so I think what Scott was saying was, yeah, you can make the investment, but, you know, you're 8 years in, like, who's replacing leadership in the firm? Who's watching over incentive compensation? Who's setting the tone, the culture? So, you know, the starting line for us is feels like more of the finishing line, which is the, you know, consummation of the transaction. That's for us, we're just, the hard work begins. Mm. Now you got to really take care of the firm, be a good steward of it. And so if you're not prepared to do all those things, you know, we think about it as, how do you source? Again, are you just waiting for the phone to ring? Doesn't happen, right? At least it's not going to happen on good stuff. So you got to go out and, you know, make stuff happen. You got to find stuff. You got to negotiate it. You got to diligence it. You got to document it well. And then you got to operate it post-close. Those are each, like, sort of 5 unique skill sets. And it's very difficult to have one person. I mean, we call it kind of the private equity firm in a box person. Very rare. That person's usually later in their career, have done everything, and still have the fire to do it. That's a very rare person to bring on. And you're going to need a big team to do it. I mean, to buy, call it 2 to 5 businesses a year, I mean, we have a team of 16 people. I mean, that's what it requires. So if you want to build as a family office that function, I mean, plan on spending a lot of money, plan on spending a lot of tuition and bad mistakes. You just have to grind through it and be committed to it long term.
So let me see if I can kind of put these points and these two perspectives together. Scott, what I'm hearing from you is there has to be a level of resources, expertise, capital, et cetera, in order to do this well. And then, Brent, what I heard from you is something similar, but you also talked about this other story, which is starting small and growing it over time. So if we were to look at the criteria that we outlined from Scott's perspective, we might say for early investments, oh, you know, Brent should definitely not be doing this kind of stuff because he doesn't have the team, he doesn't have the capital, he doesn't have all these things there, but yet you did it. Is there a way to combine those two stories together? Is it that it's really about dabbling and growing slowly if you don't have the types of criteria that make it at least a home run to do this work with more of your time?
Yeah, I would say this is where actually smaller family offices, I think in some ways, have less pressure and have more advantage, right? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, family offices now that we talk to, and we get a fair amount of family offices reach out to us and say, hey, we want to get into what you're doing. Will you help us? We always try to be magnanimous about it and try to be helpful. And one of the things I say is, like, go spend $5 million buying a business and then go operate it for 2 years before you ever think about buying another business. For most families, though, like, spending $5 million finding a deal, it's going to take time. We say to find one deal, if you're from a standing stop, it's going to be like 2 to 3 years to find a good deal. I mean, you can do any deal. You can't do good deals. To do a good deal, it's going to be 2 to 3 years, and then you're going to operate that thing for 2 or 3 years to really learn, get your feet underneath you, get, you know, learn all the hard lessons. So now you're talking about half a decade and only $5 million of capital, maybe 10 if you wanted to really blow it out. For most family offices, you're not going to have the initiative to stick with it. They're going to think that's either too small or too risky. I mean, this is where you sort of get into these feedback loops. But that's actually what it requires to build the skill set up, or you have to go hire somebody who has a track record of doing this. And the issue is, you got to look at their track record of doing it and how they did it, because that's how they're going to do it with you. And if they're used to being in a big private equity firm and doing big deals, them coming into the lower middle market is going to be a disaster. Like, it just operates differently, right? I mean, you're not going to show up in your, you know, in your private jet with a suit on and you know, strike a check and you know, you got a built out, you know, leadership management team. That's just not how it works. You know, our area of the market, it's messy. It's you know, you got to grind it out. It's difficult. And so, you know, you really got to look at depending on the size of the family office, the initiative you got to put forth really has to match the sort of the reality on the field.
Yep. Scott, I know you spend a good bit of time talking to some of these family offices as well that are thinking about direct investment or perhaps doing it. Would you give a similar response? It's something about this mix of either growing slowly over time or having the capabilities in order to do that.
Yeah, I mean, I would say most of the family offices, too, maybe just to clarify that we talk to, and I do talk to quite a few of them, they tend to be kind of bigger, but they're also doing more direct investments. So our direct investments are not the same as what Brent's doing. Like, most of our direct investments are in conjunction with a partner like Brent, so we would be co-investments, and we do them in both public and private markets, and it would be slightly different in each different market, but... You know, we're trying to cherry pick, and we love like smaller firms who tend to be capital constrained, and they're willing to put 20 or 30% of their fund in a deal, and hopefully we have a good enough relationship that we're a super early call and say like, hey, we're looking at this deal. We probably can't do it ourselves. Would you guys come look at it with us? And then we can get involved in the diligence process early on. But to go back to your question, I would say, you know, for those types of family offices, it's not the same commitment, at least our style of kind of co-investments or direct investing is not as kind of as much, you know, Brent's is more like a marriage, ours is more like, you know, mother-in-law or stepbrother or something. Like,
we're all fresh off of Thanksgiving, yeah, you all have those relationships in mind.
But you are stuck with those investments for a long period of time, So I do think like making sure you have the resources and the capabilities to actually underwrite the deal. And the truth is, like, once you're in a reasonable flow, you'll see more deals than you know what to do with. So you have to be super selective, and it takes a really good team and a different kind of mindset to build a portfolio of really good direct investments. Good.
Well, let's transition briefly to some of the research that's been done on this area. I want to go up to a framing that was done recently by Goldman Sachs. So I want to at least acknowledge at the outset that this is not by any means representative of all family offices. I think the numbers were 60% of whom have a $1 billion asset base or more, 50% of whom have an investment team of 5 or more individuals. So it's by no means representative of all the family offices that we see. But this was their answers in terms of the goals of the office. And in particular, as we all see it there, there is an 82% in the US at least that are saying their number one goal is capital appreciation for essentially intergenerational transfer. And then the second goal that was on that was a little bit lower, and that was this idea of wealth preservation. All right, so one around appreciation, one around preservation. I'm curious how we might think of the framing for an office that looks like this. So same size, $1 billion office that looks like this versus, let's say, an office that flips those goals. Office number one, let's say, really prioritize capital growth. Office number two really does something in terms of the priorities around wealth preservation. Should their approach differ when it comes to direct investment?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, we're obviously focused on more growing intergenerational wealth. There's lots of things that go in your... So I'd say, start by saying, like, look, if your primary goal is to preserve wealth or grow that wealth intergenerationally, you're going to have a very different asset allocation. So your hunting grounds are going to be very different between those two asset allocations.
And different in what kind of way? Where would you see the differences manifest?
Well, you know, if you're talking, you can take, like maybe stepping back, just like if you think about like what kind of inputs go into an asset allocation, the first one is probably time horizon, right? Do you have a 10-year time horizon, 5-year time horizon? As people get closer to retirement and they're going to need capital and want to take less principal risk, they're going to have a different asset allocation if you're just starting off in the workforce. Your kind of liquidity requirements, right? Can you be all privates or all publics? Like, how much illiquidity risk can you take over what sort of time frame? You know, what's your risk tolerance? Like, how much can you suffer a drawdown? How many years can you suffer through that drawdown? Like, all these different things going to, you know, hey, this is what I think is a reasonable asset allocation for WashU, and these are the discussions we have with the board, who ultimately approve our kind of asset allocation. But it's going to be different for every family office, probably for every institution. And then if you step back, okay, what's the primary goal of this asset allocation? Do we want to grow wealth intergenerationally, or do we want to preserve that wealth so that we maintain purchasing power for the next generation? So you, one is probably going to have a lot more, you know, commodities and real estate and fixed income. The other one's going to have a lot more private equity, you know, public equity, and aggressive kind of alternatives to take advantage of that kind of long time horizon and growth mindset.
Brent, same question. First off, maybe just given the fact that many of your investors might be in this space, do you see some offices that tilt one direction versus the other? So in other words, capital growth versus wealth preservation. You talk to an office and you're like, it seems like this is more of your goal versus others that have a different fit. And if that's the case, how does that shape how they could or should approach investing and direct investing?
Yeah, I mean, I would say, I mean, what Scott knows this world better than I do. I mean, this is, I'm probably weakest in this. I would say, you know, risk reward is where it's always going to be. And I mean, when we think about the families that put their trust in us for the long term, it was, I think, a combination of both of those things. You know, we deal in cash flow. We can hold on to cash flow. You know, we're not sure what, you know, we're not looking to sell the assets that we're buying. So we really pay attention to having a river of cash flowing through our organization. That's what we can count on. That's what we can stand on. You know, I think that's where, you know, the more that you get into speculative investments, you know, you get into art, you get into certain types of commodities, you get into, you know, high growth venture style type investing. I mean, you're banking on somebody else liquidating you at a higher value sometime down the road. It has, you know, typically nothing to do with cash flow of the asset, right? So for us, I mean, I think that's the combination of those two things. I think we fit into kind of both of those buckets for our investors. I think that the trick was for them to get comfortable with the time horizon. I think Scott talked about like time horizon. I mean, I think people could see that, you know, we're producing a lot of cash. These businesses are healthy and growing. You know, they produce a good cash yield on top of like sort of organic growth underneath them, which, you know, fits in both the wealth preservation as well as in the growth bucket. It's just a matter of, you know, is there executional risk over a 3-decade time horizon that would limit somebody's ability to feel comfortable? And I think that's, you know, predominantly what the cause of people dropping from sort of our fundraisers have been.
Yeah, so Scott, I want to follow up on this point in particular. So this idea around a longer time horizon keeps coming up. And in particular, as an investor in permanent equity, there was this piece of the time horizon that I'm sure came to mind for you. Did you have to grow to be more comfortable with that time horizon piece, or was it already a part of the way that WashU in particular was thinking?
With specifically regards to permanent equity?
Yep.
No, I mean, I think one of the early conversations that Brent and I had, I mean, like, I was skeptical that there's this private equity firm in Columbia, you know, I think rightfully so. But
I'm skeptical about that.
So, but, you know, during that first initial meeting, if you think about endowments and foundations and probably family offices as well. Like if you say you have lots of people say they have a super long time horizon, like very few firms act like it though. And the traditional kind of private equity model has all kinds of agency problems, right? So you put this artificial, like people commit capital, you have this kind of artificial timeline to invest that capital, right? So whether it's a good environment or bad environment, you typically have a 3 to 5 year kind of time frame to put that capital to work. Otherwise, they have to go back. So they're super aggressive. Hey, we're trying to put the capital to work relatively quickly, and there's other financial incentives for them to put the capital in the ground faster. So then you invest in these companies. Now, you can't invest in all different types of companies, right? Because some companies, you could say, well, this is a 10-year project, or this is a 15-year project. So we can't do that because our fund only has a 10-year life. So we're not going to do that type of so we're going to buy this investment because we think it's a five-year project. And then you buy that company and you say, like, okay, we're going to put capital in here to improve the business, but we have to do only projects that have a time horizon within our fund life, and our fund life is 10 years. So if you make that investment in fund three, right, you really need those investments to pay off in just a couple years. So you're not investing like a family-owned business would, not like permanent equity would, right? Like, we do all kinds of things in the investment office that, hey, we don't expect this to pay off for 5 or 10 years, but we still think it's a really good investment, and so we're gonna put capital to work there. But that's tough to do under that traditional structure. And then once you make that investment, right, you say it's year 7 in the fund life, well, we need to show kind of return of capital, right? So what do you end up doing? Typically, there's kind of a negative selection bias, right? They sell the winners and they hold on to the losers. And why do they do that? Well, because we can show, you know, high RRR earlier, even though like this business may compound better over the next 10 years, we're gonna sell it now and then we can return some capital to our LPs. And then that'll help make it easier for us to raise our next fund. So there's all kinds of agency problems. And I remember having a long discussion with Brent about that. Whereas, you know, as long as the incentives are properly aligned, and we have lots of discussions like that with permanent equity as well, where, hey, you know, we're super happy to be in this for 30 years if you have the right incentive structure, and permanent equity is solved for that.
So at the very front end of our conversation, you said compared to some other endowments, you might even have less in private equity, for example. Is some of that agency problem a bit of what makes you hesitate in that world?
Yeah, I mean, I would say we have very little kind of traditional large buyout private equity. Mm-hmm. Now, I'd say it varies a little bit. You know, we tend to differentiate between venture and private equity, like, hey, this is kind of business and technology risk, and this is more execution risk. So we still have a pretty decent split, but we have almost nothing in the portfolio where, you know, one of our partners is buying a company and levering it as much as they possibly can to justify a, you know, 15% kind of gross IRR. We've just sold out of almost all of that over the last kind of 4 years.
So I want to do some rapid-fire questions, really rapid-fire here, by going back to that same report. So again, this is a 2021 report out there by Goldman Sachs. And in addition to the goals, it asks for this question around what is the average asset allocation by these different areas. So you see public market equities, cash and fixed income, private equity, so on and so forth. So what I want to do in this rapid-fire format is to hear a couple different takes. Again, this is a billion-dollar-plus average family office that has 5 to 10 invested advisors along the way. So let's imagine this asset allocation, but to do three different cuts of differences. And again, rapid-fire across the board. So we'll start with Brent on the first one, and then we'll flip it as we go next. So let's imagine this is not a billion-dollar office, but this is a $50 million office. Would you anticipate any differences or suggest any differences in terms of that asset allocation?
I mean, going back to what we talked about earlier, if you've got $50 million total of assets, you can't afford a staff that's going to have the skill set that's going to be able to really evaluate a lot of the what I would call specialty assets. I mean, at that point, I think that you're, at least if it were my $50 million family office, I would want to focus much more on, you know, getting broad exposure to sort of standard beta across these asset classes. I'd probably steer away from, you know, more of the specialty, more of the alternative type stuff, or at least try to get some sort of maybe very high level broad exposure to it more easily, probably through the public markets. That would be my take on it.
Scott?
Yeah, I mean, I would say if you're $50 million, family office, again, you're probably not going to have the expertise to do a huge programs in alternative investments. So either go do that through kind of outsourced CIO, or if you have like family members who have specific expertise and network, you know, you could certainly take advantage of that specific expertise and knowledge. But outside of that, I would stay predominantly kind of public okay. markets.
This is somewhat related to that same question, but imagine that you have $50 million of investment, but you don't have any sort of investment staff in this case. What would you suggest for a group like that? Let's start with Scott now.
Yeah, I think I would go again with like some sort of either outsourced CIO or just like passive exposure.
Okay. Is there any point where you say an outsourced CIO makes sense in terms of dollar amount for an office?
Oh, you mean like outsourced CIO versus internal investment staff?
Yeah.
It's probably around that billion mark, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I would say at $50 million, no investments to have, I'd index, try to get just very, very bland exposure and try to, you know, preserve capital, ride it out through ups and downs. And I mean, the biggest thing is the psychology around it, right? I mean, not selling at the bottom and not buying at the top, I think, is if you don't have investment staff, I think it's difficult to have the intestinal fortitude to do what you should be doing. And it feels like just the exact opposite of what you should be doing at the wrong time. So
good. So last question on this rapid fire piece, and Brent, we'll start with you here. You can imagine some family offices that have, let's say, significant relevant market expertise. So imagine they just sold a company and they were in the oil and gas business, or they sold a company in office furniture, whatever it might be. They have significant expertise in a certain sector vertical versus another family office family that's a little bit separated out from relevant market expertise. Would that shape how they would approach direct investment?
I mean, for me, for sure. I mean, if you've got a deep expertise in something, I mean, I think the best possible returns come from leveraging your time and your expertise against your money, right? I mean, that's a compounding effect right there. I mean, if you've got an oil and gas expertise and that's where all your relationships are and you know the best people and you have great judgment, like, the dumbest thing in the world would be to not use that. At least the way I'm talking is, if you don't have that type of experience, if there's really no expertise and it's more removed, then I think that's where you want to just get as much broad exposure as you possibly can.
Scott, same question. You mentioned this a bit already in terms of leveraging expertise in the family or network in the family. How would you think about that same framing?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would just echo what Brent said. If you don't have that, I would say, like, you need to be really cautious. And again, going back to, like, hey, why is this deal in my lap, mm-hmm. right? If you can't add value to the deal, particularly if you're not a huge capital, like, lots of reasons why you would say, like, hey, I wasn't the first call here. And probably some smart money's already passed on the deal. Mm-hmm.
A fool and his money are invited everywhere.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
All right, so I want to shift a little bit in a slightly different direction and talk about team design and networks. So how you build out the team and how you leverage some of the benefit of partnerships along the way. I was listening, Scott, to a recent interview that you ran maybe about a year ago on the Capital Allocators podcast. And you talked about building a team of generalists, not having someone specified certain areas. Can you talk a little bit about that generalist model, why you think it's beneficial and how it varies from other approaches?
Yeah, so there's pros and cons. Obviously, there's benefit to specialization, particularly in investing. The reason we do that generalist model, one is we take a team approach to everything. So chances are, if somebody on the team has a specific expertise for whatever reason in a specific area, they'll be one of the generalist staff to whatever deal. So typically, we have 3 to 5 people, and Brent can probably testify to this. If he would come into the office, everybody in the office on the investment staff would probably be in the meeting.
Just, when he says everyone, he means literally everyone. They have like a giant board table. I think it was like 3 of us that came in, and there was like, felt like 35 of them.
We thought there were going to be 2 of you.
Like literally, like it was very intimidating. And they were all taking notes. And I was like, what could they be possibly saying about me?
Yes. Yeah, no, anyway.
Well, let me just pause there for a second, because I love that idea. Is it that the 20 people, the 10 people around the room are going to see slightly different things? They'll pick up on different things that can be leveraged, the collective intelligence, to guide that decision? What's the value of that? Because it's inefficient in other ways.
It's definitely inefficient in lots of ways. But the value of that is, one, like, the younger people see, like, how the meeting's held, interactions, questions are asked. Like, they're learning a little bit through osmosis. And they're writing things down. And they may be taking notes. They may be like, oh, I didn't understand it when Brent said this. So I'll follow up with somebody to explain that to me afterwards. So it really helps the younger generation get up to speed quicker. And it grows kind of institutional knowledge so that everybody sees kind of broadly what we're looking at, what's in the pipeline. And ultimately, we do this generalist model because we want all kind of different asset classes and investments to compete for capital. So even at $16 billion or wherever we're at this morning, you know, we're still capital constrained, right? We can't do every investment that comes in the door. And so ultimately, we're trying to find what's the best use, marginal use of capital right now. And there's lots of things that go into that, but clearly we want different types of investments to compete for capital at the margin. And that's why we end up doing a generalist model.
So Brent, you've spoken about being a generalist as well in the sense that it's not like you only do aviation deals. It's not like you only do in-ground pool deals, right? You might see some different approaches there. So with that in mind, how do you structure a team to be somewhat industry agnostic, more generalist in your approach?
Yeah, well, it's really interesting because we don't think of ourselves as generalists. We're trying to go after a very specific thing. So unlike Scott's team, they're scouring the globe, and you know they're in Africa and South America and Asia looking for opportunities. That's why he couldn't believe there would be somebody. Jesus can't be an expert in his hometown, so I guess we can't either, right? Right down I-70, there's an investment firm they want to partner with. We think of ourselves as deep specialists in a style of company, in a size of company, in a sort of the stage of the company's in. The companies that we love that are the best for us, and these can kind of range in size. It's hard to give you exact parameters. We call them kind of adolescent businesses. So these are businesses that are too big to be small and too small to be big. And we love them because they have enough momentum and enough meat to them where they're less fragile than smaller businesses. But they also have a lot of room for improvement, and you're able to buy them a lot cheaper. So we think there's actually like kind of a double whammy of goodness that we get with the deals that we do because we're buying them cheaper and there's more room for upside. And so that requires a very specific skill set and a lot of patience and a lot of trial and error and a long time horizon and the low use of debt to be able to do all that really, really well. And so we think of ourselves as, yes, we're in aviation and construction and manufacturing and military recruitment and on like matchmaking. We're all over the board in a lot of things that we do. So it can look very like we are generalists, but each one of those businesses is facing very similar problems, and we're trying to do very similar things in each one of them and move them from being less risky, sort of, you want to think about it as like moving the band of outcomes, the deviation of outcomes upward, right? So reducing risk and increasing upside constantly. That's what we think about every day. We're getting out of bed and we're saying, how are we going to take this basket of assets, the people, right? Work with the people to move these things in the right direction. And so when we go and talk to a firm that's doing manufacturing and a firm that's doing services, they're all doing the same thing. It's just a matter of what is the actual function itself. They're good at that. If we're doing our job well, the business itself is being run well. It's the everything tastes like chicken layer that always has opportunities for improvement.
Okay, that's great. So let's look at relationships now outside of the focal firm or endowment or team. And in particular, extend it to consideration of your network of partners. So each of you in different ways has spoken about the value that you get from a network of co-investors or network of investors that are alongside your work, whatever the case may be. I'm curious how you think about identifying who is a valuable partner in the work and leveraging learning from those partners.
Yeah, I would say the relationship right here is prototypical for us of what we're looking for. We're looking for somebody who's going to have our back when things get hard, who's going to be understanding that this is a messy, difficult thing that we do, going to thank us for the hard work that we do, and be a humble thought partner. We brought them a couple deals this year that we said, hey, we think there's a little too large, these are a little outside of our comfort zone. Will you help us give us another set of eyes? And it was incredibly valuable to just be able to have this, like, no one's puffing up, no one's trying to put up, a facade that's different. We're just being honest about what we're looking at, and we're trying to get their thoughtful feedback. And to their credit, too, they're like, hey, this is our feedback, but, like, if you guys want to do the deal, do the deal. So it's very much like they've been, truly, I'm not just blowing smoke here, like, ideal partners to us. In the sense of, they've given us a lot of control and they've given us a lot of support, and that has in turn made us want to go to them more often than anybody to get feedback and advice and to help with what we're doing.
Scott, same question. So when it comes to, again, these networks, and you have relationship networks inside the university that are important, you have investment networks, you have those that you invest in. How do you think about that concentrated set of relationships and leveraging the value of them?
I guess. The first thing I'd say, you should lead, and maybe this is all walks of life, but we try and lead those relationships. First off, we're trying to provide value, right? And you never really know how good a relationship is until you really need a favor or need something. And then someone who's willing to go out of their way to help you out for whatever reason makes a huge difference. So first off, we whenever we can add value, which quite frankly isn't that often with most of our external partners, but if they do need something, if we can provide an introduction or they want to speak to somebody at the university or, we've had people literally in our office go and collect engineering resumes by hand from like students that were like, go get recommendations from professors, go to those students like, hey, you want to work at this company?
Wait, you guarantee guys do that? It. That's a service you guys provide?
We will.
That's fantastic.
Absolutely.
That's,
hey, that's great. Sign us up.
And then like, you know, FedEx those resumes to the company because they're like, hey, we need like these specific type of engineers. So like, one, we can't always add value, but whenever we can, we try and do that. And then two, like we're, you know, I would say fairly aggressive about, you know, developing those relationships before we invest. Mm. So hopefully you have some reasonable idea in that, like, hey, we didn't just do several meetings. We may have went out and met some of your portfolio companies, or, you know, we did calls with other partners. We did calls with management team or people who used to work at the firm. And so we know something about that. And our diligence process is generally in-depth enough that you have a fairly good understanding. But still, you know, you never know how those relationships are going to be until you're kind of in them.
Well, and I want to push on that point a bit, because one of the things that you talked about is the importance of assessing competence of, let's say, the managers that you're working on. So we're going to look at their investment decisions. We're going to assess whether or not they align with how we would approach the decision. But in that same podcast, you also mentioned the importance of assessing value alignment, integrity, a sense of whether or not this is someone who has a similar set of concerns that we have as a university. Yeah. I would imagine the first piece is difficult to assess, but it's a bit more of a technical challenge. Yeah. And the second piece is a little bit fuzzier. How do you go about assessing the integrity of your partners?
Yeah, there's not a checklist, I would say. I always tell the team, look, we're looking for somebody we think has a similar moral compass, right? People are like, what's important to us is important to them. I think it's how they treat their people. It's how they hire people. It's how they fire people. It's the relationships they have with their companies, their other LPs, you know, even other LPs who may or may not have invested, right? So like, you can learn a lot. And I actually think like it's pretty easy to learn a lot about the culture of a firm if you know not just the like head of the firm, right? If you know layer number 2, 3, and 4, and you talk to those people, you get a pretty good sense. Like, does this person hire good people? Do they stay at the firm? Are they treated well? And then how they deal with their companies, particularly how they deal with the like the portfolio companies when things don't go well, right? Or you know, dealing with individual employees when things don't go well. And investing is messy. Nobody bets 1,000 and nothing is a straight line up and to the right. So, you know, there's always periods of time where things are working at varying levels of degrees of success.
Yeah, so Brent, I want to ask that same question, but for you when assessing companies. You're obviously assessing the market potential, you're assessing the team, you're assessing the opportunity, but also to some degree assessing the people. You mentioned that several times.
Yep.
What are the ways that you go about that same type of assessment when assessing companies directly?
Yeah, it was actually interesting to hear Scott talk about their process because I was like matching up to the process that we went through with them. And
where was yours better versus
like literally, his team knows like every single person on our staff, and they have contact with like literally every single person on our staff, down to the entry level. Like it's like really interesting how they walk the walk. Anyway, how we do it? We're trying to. Spend time with people. I mean, as simple as that stands, I mean, like, I think most financial transactions, it's almost like a rush to the altar, and especially in private equity right now. I mean, that's one of the things we could talk about trends and kind of one of the unsettling trends that we've seen is a rush to consummate the transaction. And of course, it's driven by an intermediary. It's driven by market pressures, by competition, and we have really bucked hard against that. I mean, we lost 3 deals this year that we really wanted, that the intermediary was just like, if you guys can't guarantee a close within 45 days, like, well, doesn't matter. Like, and we're like, we can't guarantee that because we want to spend time with the people. We want to develop a relationship. We're going to be in a relationship with them for decades, hopefully. How in the world could we do that in 45 days? Now, we said we'll do everything we can. We'll spend time with them. You know, we're never the slow ones is what we say, but we do want to spend time with people. And so it looks like multiple trips. It looks like multiple settings. It's how they treat the wait staff. It's how they treat their employees. It's how they talk about their employees. It's the how they make decisions. It's matching up what they say versus what they do. And look, we don't have like a hard and fast rule of like, you know, we have our portfolio CEOs are all over the map. Some are incredibly blue collar. Some are not. Some live a very lavish lifestyle. Some of them live a very simple lifestyle. Like, we don't care about that stuff. What we care about is that you match your sort of walk and talk. And really, I mean, what we're trying to do, it's in some ways, it's personal brand, right? It's a predictability of outcomes that you really want. Is we want to be able to understand who we're working with and predict their behavior and know when likely we're going to trip a wire and get them triggered and have a situation on our hands, right? And everyone's got trigger points. And so we're trying to understand what frustrates them, what are they sensitive about, what are they insecure about, what are they maybe overconfident about, what's their sort of, you know, circle of competence, to kind of use that terminology. We're all trying to, you know, ping a lot of these different things. And so what does it look like practically? It looks like a lot of our team members spending a lot of time with their team members and all of us comparing notes. And I think it's the exact same thing for what Scott does, at least from what we can tell.
That's great. So let's talk a bit about the trends in the private equity and venture capital space, because I could see that being a way that some families might get into this, not directly investing in a single company who has a novel technology in the healthcare space, but rather investing in a fund that's doing this sort of work. And so I want to quickly pull up a few trends here. This, again, going back to the same Goldman Sachs study, this was looking at these billion-dollar-plus family offices. It found that broadly about 100% of them had exposure to private equity, and about 90 to 95% of them had exposure to venture capital. But one of the things we actually got into a conversation with over email yesterday was a trend that my good friend Stephen Douglas sent our way earlier on, and it's about this chart here on the left. And in fact, Scott, you sent a chart or a document shortly afterwards from PitchBook that I pulled another chart that's relevant as well on the right. And what you see here on the left is work that has been done broadly. This is out of Bain and Company, that was looking at the multiples paid in the PE side. And I love this chart in the sense that when you look at 2003, what is it, about 5% or less were paying greater than 11x multiples on EBITDA. And by 2020, that's two-thirds of the deals had happened in that space. So we can think of the private equity on the left-hand side. On the venture side, this is multi-stage firms impacting valuations, pre-money valuations of company growing over about a 10-year period. Same thing, massive growth in terms of the valuations of those businesses. So I'm curious from each of you, because you have different models of investment, how you see these trends and what that might shape in terms of what you do in terms of your investment decisions as a result. So Scott, why don't you get us started?
Sure. I mean, these are both super relevant for us in that, you know, ultimately, like, our primary job is allocating capital to private equity and venture firms that that are out there in the marketplace trying to do deals. I would say, you know, the one thing, if you look across our portfolio, I would say every partnership has in common is they're all price-sensitive investors. Now, they may be venture, they may be growth, they may be private equity, public equity, but they're all very price-sensitive investors. And we've still seen it kind of across the portfolio. You know, if somebody invests in round A and comes around round C or D, like, you still have this inflation because it may have been our partner that led Series A that gave us our exposure. But in later stage rounds, it's somebody else who just paid a valuation that we think is crazy. So you have two different kind of routes you can take. You can sell it in the secondary market or you can hold it. But those secondary markets for you're sending a poor message to the team saying, like, hey, we don't like your portfolio, and, you know, probably they're not going to be happy with you. There is a lot of these gains, I think, in private portfolios are paper, right? They haven't been realized, and you know, we'll see how that plays out, but I think it's at a minimum, it's probably slightly overstated returns, and it could severely overstate returns in people's venture and growth portfolios across kind of all institutional capital bases. And then we've also had we have to be super selective about the partners that we choose, because we don't want people out there chasing returns. And if you look at the number of kind of big pension funds or sovereign wealth funds who have missed the party in private equity and venture and growth over the last two decades, who are now, like, massively increasing their asset allocation, and they're big pools of capital, right? They're single sovereign wealth funds that have as much in assets as all the endowments combined. If they decide to move a 10% shift to private equity and venture, like, that exacerbates this problem.
And it's a similar process in the sense that you're assessing your potential partners based on how they're approaching their own investment. Are they price sensitive? Are they over investing? That's a filter that you would have when looking to these individuals.
Absolutely, yeah. And we do that by basically digging in on the underlying kind of deals themselves and say, okay, what did you pay for this company and why?
Which is, again, very time-intensive to do that versus just looking at the returns at the fund level.
And I also think if you look at the historical returns, you know, where you were paying less than 5 times or you were paying less than 10 times sales for a software company, and you take the entire kind of ecosystem and you double, triple, quadruple the valuation and pro forma what those returns would have looked like, it's not very good. So I think there's going to be a lot of disappointed investors and investment committees in these sectors over the next decade or longer because, you know, you could say they're more efficient now, but certainly at current multiples, I wouldn't expect the same returns going forward that we've enjoyed over the last decade.
So Brent, you live in this world on the left, a different slice of this world, but nonetheless, this is the world that you live in. What do you interpret this side as being, again, this growth of multiples paid, and how does it shape how your team engages?
Yeah, it's really funny. We joke, the Mitt Romney has this like great quote, I think it was in some article that they were being interviewed, this is back when he was at Bain, and it was so funny, it's like a time capsule in the private equity industry, and he's like basically sounding the alarm of like, well, I'm not sure the industry is going to be able to enjoy, you know, the type of returns that have been, you know, they've been used to because multiples are starting to creep above 7 times. Mm-hmm. Like that was his kind of like, and I think that was in the 90s, right?
A grainy video.
And yeah, exactly. And you know, how far have we come? I mean, you're looking at 2003 right there. I mean, you know, you look in less than 7 times was 40% of the industry, right? So it's it definitely probably back in Mitt's heyday, it was, you know, probably 80, 90% of deals were done under 7 times, right? So if you're going to pay more, then you got to believe sort of, well, one of three things is going to happen, right? You can use more debt to just juice the equity returns, which is what I think a lot of private equity firms have done, is just increase the leverage as much, just go max leverage, right? As much leverage as you can possibly get. And that's where, for large cap, especially private equity, what we've seen is just the relationships don't matter on the buy side anymore. So like the sellers are selling, not because they like a certain buyer more or less, or they think the attributes of a certain buyer are better than the attributes of the other. The only thing that matters is price. So if the only thing that matters is price, and the game is just how do you pay more, it's how do you get more leverage. And so where do the relationships actually matter for large cap private equity is actually in the debt providers. Like that's actually, it's like, how do I get a debt provider to give me an extra turn of leverage, which actually gives me the ability to get an extra turn to win the deal, right? So debt is one way you can do it, which, you know, let's just state the obvious, you know, debt doesn't increase returns, it amplifies returns. So it just makes something, you know, better if it goes well, and it makes it a lot worse if it goes even mediocre. So that's one option. The second option is potentially, and I don't think this is personally true, but the quality of the assets has just gotten better. So there's something sort of like a technological or sort of a secular trend. And I think that in the VC space, I think the argument is a lot stronger that maybe is the case. There are certain attributes of, you know, because of Amazon Web Services, anybody can launch a business, you can grow the business, you know, more easily, whatever that may be, right? Yep. You know, if you think about being remote and the ability for remote work or remote first work, unlocking talent might be I'm using this not to say that I believe that these are the case, but these would be good arguments if I were going to make an argument for, you know, seed valuations on the venture side. On the private equity side, it's hard for me to believe that manufacturers today are just higher quality assets than manufacturers were 15, 20 years ago. Like, it's just hard for me to see what would be the reason. I mean, technology is going to improve businesses for sure, no doubt, but like, are they that much more, you know, if you're manufacturing a physical good, like, right? Like, is it that much better? Like, somehow are the firms able to increase their margins by that much more to make the quality of the asset higher to where it's worth paying more for? Because you got to remember, we're all doing this on a multiple basis. So the earnings, you would think, if the quality was there, meaning the higher quality asset, well, then that would drop to the bottom line. You'd have an increase in earnings as a result of that. I buy that. Maybe that's true. Maybe technology is helping increase earnings and increase margin in these businesses. Gross margin, net margin, whatever it is. But you're still paying for that. So at closing, you're still paying for that already increased quality. And so that's what I'm saying is I don't believe that that's the case. Like, I don't think that overall the business quality is increasing. And so to me, the final thing, the option, like there's only 3 doors, right? The third door is just you're accepting lower returns. And I think that everyone right now in the private equity world is sort of looking at each other and wink, wink. I mean, you can, you know, comment to this far better than I can, but like, I mean, people are kind of whispering, oh yeah, we're still aiming for low 20s gross returns. Like, I think everyone's kind of whispering, like, it's gonna be like low teens gross returns, hopefully. And that's with a ton of debt layered on top. So for us, and so I'm gonna kind of zoom in from like, that's a kind of broad private equity. For us, I mean, we are very aware of how difficult the businesses are that we buy. So we are buying, Scott, I think heard me use this term before, is like, we buy loosely functioning disasters that happen to make money, right? Like, all small businesses are loosely functioning disasters. They are incredibly fragile, they're difficult, you know, there's a lot of concentration and skill sets in certain individuals and relationships and expertise, institutional memory, there's a lack of system. I mean, it sounds like this is like terrible. I'm painting a dour picture. It's wonderful because each one of those is opportunities to improve the business, right? It's the way we look at it. But you got to know what you're buying. And so one of the things we talk about on our team a lot is we know we're buying 20, 30, 50 years of problems, 20, 30, 50 years of failures, 20, 30 years of stuff that we don't know, skeletons in the closet. And you just never know what you're buying. There's no amount of due diligence you can do to know what you're buying until after close. So, you know, somebody asked me recently, like, how many of the deals have you guys done have gone south? And I've said all of them. Like, you know, our returns are great, but like all of the deals we've done have had major stumbles, major problems post-close. Now, again, those are opportunities because the business was making what the business was making, the business was what it was. So those are opportunities to increase, again, decrease the risk, increase the upside in those opportunities. But in our specific area of the market, I mean, I would say is, most people don't realize how hard it is, especially if you're coming from upmarket private equity, kind of coming downward, and just how different the mentality is and how different the sort of the style of investing is. Sure. And so for us, we are starting to see some uptick in pricing. But what I would say is that the uptick in pricing is all from people who are unfamiliar with, who are inexperienced in this area of the market. So like we lost, you know, we joke, you know, we're losing deals typically to large funds that are trying to come down and maybe tack something on that they have no idea what they're buying, right? Or, you know, the son or daughter of a billionaire who says, oh my gosh, guess what? We can pay 7-8 times. Isn't that better than paying 30 times? Let's go buy a small business. That's how you lose all your money, right? Having that expertise is really important to understand really like the downside. The easy part is what the numbers say. Like, it's not complicated. These businesses are very simple, the size that we're operating at. It's very understandable what the business is, and the numbers are very straightforward. Now, the accounting systems are a disaster, and half the time, when you do the, you know, sort of quality of earnings work on them, they come out with radically different, you know, financials than what you thought they were going to be. And so that's, again, where you got to, you know, pay for the tuition, yep, pay for the education to understand kind of what you're getting into. And so the skill set required in our area of the market keeps some people out and keeps a lot of people out. It's just too hard. And a lot of funds can't get basically institutional dollars because the way their fund's set up to kind of go down market as far as we are. So we like the area that we're in. You know, it's more professionalized. It's larger than sort of the really, really low end where it's just like the Wild Wild West. But it's still small enough where it, you know, it keeps out kind of some of the up market.
That's great. So I want to do one more question for you, Scott, and then we're going to transition to see if there's any questions that are online that we might have some time for. And in particular, there's nothing like an academic presentation that throws up some Journal of Financial Economics papers. But I promise you, I will be
brief. I was just looking at these the other day.
Oh, yeah, who wasn't? So a few of these pieces that were done by Paul Gompers, Steve Kaplan, and a few others, including some University of Chicago folks, that were looking at how VCs and PE funds make decisions and what it is they think it actually is that creates some of the value. So on the VC side, one of the key takeaways here was that their value add, or at least their stated value add, was that it's about selecting people. Not only that, but a central piece of selecting people and talent in the upfront, even more so than the business and the team. And then on the private equity firm side, many of them said that some of the value that they had, this goes actually a bit, Brent, to your point earlier, they say that the value they have is actually in driving the revenue side versus driving down the cost side. So, Scott, I'm wondering, as you assess opportunities to invest in the VC side or the PE side, what it is that you're looking at in terms of the capabilities of those teams and whether it matches up with some of what we see from these two studies?
I would say loosely. I would probably question the validity or, you know, I would say the standard error probably around these types of studies is super high, and I haven't read the studies, but... You know, every VC firm, like if you meet with 100 VC firms, they're all going to tell you pretty much the exact same thing. And it's there's on private equity probably less overlap, but still very similar. So you know, if I had to like make up a checklist on the spot, you know, we're looking in venture for people who say they have, like, who we think have a sourcing advantage, a specific kind of expertise, ability to understand business, you know. And when I say that, it's like, do they understand unit economics, size of the market, returns on invested capital, ultimately, like how this business actually makes money. And that's hard to do in venture, and it takes a certain type of imagination and framework that I personally like wouldn't be good at, and I know that from real experience. I can give you examples where I'm like, this business is never going to work, and now it's a $30 billion business. And on the private equity side, you know, and to less extent on the venture side, you know, can they add value to these companies? How can they add value to these companies outside of being just a source of capital? Right? Can they put in institutional like operations and controls and help? Like kind of recruit good C-level candidates and add value over the course of that business's life. In private equity, it's very similar. It's probably more focused on that kind of later stage. Like private equity tends to be highly disintermediated, so sourcing network may or may not be as much proprietary, but how do they underwrite the business? How do they think about markets? How do they think about, you know, taking that business from where it is when they buy it to how it becomes a business that they can either run for great cash flow or sell it at a premium 5 years, 10 years down the road. So it's similar, and I would say like every firm is slightly different. Again, you know, the stuff we spoke about earlier still applies. We're looking for good people we think we can have close relationships with and really understand not only their historical investments and how those came to be, but also someone we think we can work super closely with over the course of our partnership with them.
Okay. So let's see if we can go to a few questions to close our time out here together. There's some good ones that have come in as we've been talking. One of the questions that I think is relevant to both of you comes from Daryl. And Daryl is wondering about how you align incentives and compensation of your team with this longer-term horizon. So do you have to think about the way that you structure not just the team interaction, but also the compensation that makes this work?
Yeah, I mean, we have a completely, I think, unique fee model in the industry, and so we have a unique compensation model for our team that we just want everyone to be aligned on the same metrics. And so our metrics are, it's all based on cash flow. Like, we want to incentivize the companies to produce cash flow. We want to defer that cash flow into reinvestments if we can generate a high rate of return with a high probability, and all the way up the chain. So how we incentivize the executive teams and the decision makers in the companies is exactly how we incentivize our team, which again then is exactly how we get paid and how our investors make money. And so for us, it's all cash flow based. Everyone's on a percentage of free cash flow or some variation of that, and it works great for us. In the private equity world, that is crazy. No one does it that way. Everyone's on carry. Everyone gets paid salary, maybe some bonus, and then has a, you know, sort of pot at the end of the rainbow. We want the consistency. We don't want moonshots. We want people to be in the grind day to day, and we want to see them to see the fruits of that. So we typically do quarterly distributions of cash flow and people sharing that in the company. So
Scott, we'll do a couple kind of back and forth in this space, but sure. There's a few people that are wondering how you and the team are thinking about crypto in particular.
Yeah.
Outside of companies.
So I was just in Lisbon a couple weeks ago at this crypto conference called Breakpoint, which was put on by this cryptocurrency, Solana. But we spent a ton of time in crypto. Again, I wouldn't say it's a large portion of the portfolio. We've had partners who have been active in crypto since prior to my arriving at WashU. I think the first Bitcoin position was purchased in 2014. Over the last kind of 2-3 years, it's become a larger portion. We have a handful of direct investments in the crypto space, and I would say more picks and shovel type businesses. But we found it super interesting. It's gotten a little bit frothy, in that I think the valuations in a lot of cases maybe are a little bit ahead of themselves. But we think it's a super interesting space, and there'll be trillions of dollars of additional market cap created over the next couple decades in that space. Now, we're not going to bet on which kind of L1, L2 protocol, for those that care about that, is going to be the most successful one. Like, we have no expertise there. but there's a lot of super interesting business and business models being created in the space.
Brent, there's a question out there, and you've hit on this a bit already, but a question around how you generate returns when holding for the long term, right? You've
carefully.
You've highlighted this piece around the cash flow, but you have to think of businesses that will generate 2x the kind of cash flow that you would see in another kind of business that you'd invest in. How do you approach the returns?
I mean, for us, it's just super straightforward. I mean, if we're buying it typically between a 3 and 6 times multiple, let's say, really, I mean, kind of our sweet spot is in that kind of 4 to 5 range, I would say, in terms of buying. You're starting with a cash yield of 20 to 25%. These businesses are organically growing at, you know, call it 8 to 10% per year, full cycle anyway. We have a history of being able to, you know, increase that growth rate as a result of, you know, helping add more structure, you know, adding best practices in all these key areas. And we take a patient approach, right? We try not to screw things up. I mean, anytime you're making a change, there's opportunity cost to everything, right? So we're very careful not to, you know, sort of the first rule is like in medicine, like do no harm. And then, you know, try to upside from there. But I would say is it's very straightforward. We take a the percentage of free cash flow typically is around 70-ish percent that we think that is not useful in the portfolio right now. We're buying typically very asset-light businesses, throw off a lot more cash than they can consume. If we, you know, took all the free cash flow and just dumped it into growth, like, they would just kind of go spin around the cul-de-sac faster. Like, they wouldn't do anything. And so there's a certain percentage every year that we can take and we can reinvest at really high rates of return, but we have a high opportunity cost, and if it doesn't exceed that, then we dividend it out to our investors. That's how families work, right? Like, so it's very first principles. It's like, we're literally operating these companies very similarly, hopefully with more expertise and skill set that is normal in smaller family companies, but exact same way from a cash dynamics. And I mean, the numbers work out great. I mean, over the long term, if you can grow and compound capital at, you know, 15, 20% per year, I mean, your returns are outrageous. If you can compound it 6 to 8% per year and buy it 4 to 5 times, you're still really good. And that's our kind of base case.
So let's end briefly with one piece of advice you might give to a family office who's considering changing their approach to direct investing off of our conversation here. Is there one tip that you might give people as they lead this time together? Scott?
You know, I guess my advice would be, hey, whatever problem you're looking at, someone's probably solved it before, so go out and seek it, like, be humble, ask for advice, ask, you know, people in your network what the right approach would be, and start slowly, you know, kind of $1 at a time if they're making kind of planning significant changes to their process.
Okay. Brent?
Yeah, I mean, I would say be humble is a thing. I mean, it's like, don't be afraid to jump in and learn, but I would say, you know, putting skin in the game and learning slowly is what I would do. I would just, you know, you'd sort of go slow to go fast, right? I mean, it, compounding, you know, it's difficult for us to imagine how it actually works. And I think that's what, if I look at, you know, our history is, look at us as like a family office that then professionalized, like, had a tiny microscopic amount of capital, like I barely could get an SBA loan, right? And then you take that and you pay that off and you compound it a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more. Well, because we didn't have outside capital at that point, it actually allowed us to be patient and allowed us to build the systems and build the processes that then allowed us now to go a lot faster and a lot further. Mm-hmm. If we had had, you know, if, I mean, I say this all the time, but like, if we had had, you know, $30 million to play with in our second year, I would have lost all that money. Like, we just were not ready for it. So I think understanding what you're ready to handle and what you're not ready to handle, and it's just, it all comes down to humility and self-awareness.
Well, Scott and Brent, this has been a great conversation. I really appreciate you driving into town and driving across town to be able to join us here today. I do want to say as we close here, this is the first out of 3 parts of a series. We dealt with the idea around direct investment today. We're going to transition in early February with more information to come around how you might think about impact investing in particular. And then finally, once we get to April, we'll be dealing more with the philanthropic side around strategies for doing philanthropy in a slightly different way. But it's been a pleasure to be with you. And again, thanks everyone for joining us here today.
Thanks a lot.
Yep, thanks for having me.